Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting in 2016 of the Health and Sport Committee. And I would ask everyone, as I normally do at this time, to switch off any mobile phones, as sometimes they can interfere with the sound system or certainly interfere with the proceedings of the meeting. But you will notice that there are some of us using tablet devices, and this is instead of our hard copies of our papers. First item on the agenda today is a decision on whether the committee will consider agenda item 5 in private. This consideration of the main themes arising from today's evidence session on the final report of the Penrose Inquiry, it's usual that we would take our consideration in private. Can I have the committee's agreement? Thank you. We now move to our second item, which, of course, is the final report on the Penrose Inquiry. And today we will take oral evidence on that report from Petra Wright. Petra Wright. Scottish.
As fond of her as I am, Chairman.
We are not indeed brother, sister, or whatever.
So we've got Petra Wright, Scottish Officer, Hepatitis C Trust. Welcome, Philip Dolan, Convener, Scottish Infected Blood Forum, and Bill Wright, Chair, Haemophilia Scotland. Welcome to you all. And in the interest of time, I think we're going to move directly to questions. And the first question is from Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. Firstly, can I thank you as Convener and also the committee for holding this session as a session which I'm sure many people who have been affected in regards to the Penrose Inquiry welcome. In my questions, I've got several today, Convener, if you'll allow me. But I think we have to have a slight look at the history. 1999, the then Scottish Executive announced an internal inquiry into contaminated blood. 2000, the Health and Community Care Committee, this committee, that was a previous name, launched its own inquiry. 2004, the Skipton Fund was established. 2006, the Health Committee calls for a full public inquiry. 2007, the Scottish Government confirms it will honour a manifesto commitment to hold a public inquiry. 2008, Lord Penrose was appointed in January 2009, and the Penrose Inquiry final report was published in 2015. 17 years it has taken to come to this situation. And can I welcome the three witnesses today? And I would like to ask them, it has been said that the Penrose Inquiry didn't cover all the issues raised by the campaign. We've been given examples of medical records, but there were other aspects of disaster which weren't covered. What is your view and what was not covered by the Penrose Inquiry?
Mr. Wright.
Well, I think you'll be well aware that those of us who endured the six-year-long inquiry, the common term that was used was it was a whitewash. I think a six-year-long inquiry costing £12 million like that came to only one recommendation, does actually bring the whole inquiry system into dispute itself and the Inquiries Act and the Inquiries Regulations. Now, we believe that that's an issue for a future parliament. It's an issue that stretches right across the whole of public consideration. For example, recently with the trams inquiry, the chairman has had to alter the situation there because it's moved from being a non-judicial inquiry to a judicial inquiry in order that witnesses could be compelled. One of the aspects that I think we have been found most troubling was the fact that while it was a six-year-long inquiry, there was a three-year gap between the end of the public hearings and the report being published in March last year. Now, any reasonable person, when told that a public inquiry has to be held transparently funded by the taxpayer, it's reasonable to expect that the whole of its proceedings would be transparent. Now, I'm very aware that the chairman was limited in terms of the Inquiries Act because of what's called maxwellisation that you may well be more familiar with in relation to the Chilcot inquiry. But that was 3 years where we were left in the complete dark, wondering what was happening in terms of the toing and froing between the chairman and his team and those witnesses who may well have been subject to criticism in the first draft of the report. We simply do not know what was happening there at that point. And we find that extremely frustrating, potentially time-wasting. People died during that period due to their infections. And we would very much urge all parliamentarians in looking to the next session of the Scottish Parliament to consider looking at the inquiry system as a whole and making, if necessary, amendments to potentially both the Inquiries Act and the Inquiries Regulations. But that's a matter for a future date.
Anyone else? Mr. Dolan. Yes.
Want me to press one of these things?
Yes.
I think I agree with what Bill has said and many of the things he said. I think what troubles me and members of the Scottish Infected Blood Forum, which, as I've said in my documentation, represents people who were infected with haemophilia, and I've put in my history about a history of the background since I've been, I feel like I've been haunting this place and the corridors with black and white tiles for many, since 1999. But I think the issues that are concerned were the fact that many people wanted to be witnesses, wanted to give their story, and they weren't heard. I've actually distributed this morning, for you to read it later, the stories that some of the witnesses, some of the people affected, would have liked to give their story, etc. I'm equally concerned that the way that the Penrose Inquiry treated this thing, the fact there's nothing to mention about the missing medical records, batch numbers that people had. There's nothing in it about the fact that people like Lord David Owen and Patrick Jenkins, both health ministers in Westminster, found documents that they had suddenly when they got to the Department of Health were shredded, unfortunately, by a junior member of staff there. But as I say, coming back to the witnesses, and I think I did put in my statement, my concern was that when we raised the issue about the way the Penrose Inquiry took place, only six witnesses were called from the victims. There were plenty of witnesses for doctors, scientists, Department of Health, and all the rest of it. But where were the witnesses? And when the counsel for the victims, well, first and foremost, I went on record with the fact that many people want to be core participants. And Lord Penrose, at the end of the day, only allowed six of those to be permitted to give. And the solicitor and the appeal was heard by Lord Penrose himself, which goes against natural justice for a judge to hear appeal against his own decision. But even more concerning was the fact when the counsel was saying on my behalf, talking about hepatitis C, he said, the counsel said, Mr. Dolan has the sword of Damocles hanging over his head. And Lord Penrose's response was, you mean a feather duster? And that's how dismissive it was, that was seen, that nothing. And there was nothing we could say. And I sat in the background, like many other people, not allowed to say anything. But the fact that that's how dismissive it was, it just left me, as I'd said elsewhere, that from the very first day, when Lord Penrose made his initial statement back there saying that this is funded by NHS, every pound spent is a pound away from patient care, every doctor appears as every doctor appears as time away from the health service. There's nothing to say about what about all the people. Sitting in that audience that day were a number of widows or widowers, families whose relatives have died. They didn't seem to exist as far as the inquiry is concerned. And as I say, the fact that so few patients, two of the people that were heard at that hearing were heard because the legal people had taken a case under the Human Rights Act. And at least, so the court of session insisted they both were heard. So that really came down to just about four other people were heard. So to me, the first day I said it was a whitewash, and the last day I said it was a whitewash there. And as I say, I'm concerned. I spent, I must say, years and years and years going back there, way back into the 80s and beforehand, trying to campaign to get some justice. Justice doesn't necessarily mean just the financial part. Justice is getting an answer for why this happened, and that is not in there in the Penrose Inquiry. Sorry.
I'm going to let Ms. Wright to respond to the first question, and then I'll maybe take some supplementaries in and around the inquiry process as it's been raised. And then, of course, I'll come I'm back and make you, let, allow you to make some further.
Of course, I wasn't personally involved in the Penrose Inquiry. However, what I'd like to comment on is actually, you're talking about the length of time that's been taken here. I think we've been waiting something around 30 years, but it's obviously 17 years since the inquiry process came along. And for me as a person with hepatitis C, to come with one recommendation at so much cost that effectively says, please go and test people and find those who are infected. Now, that's something that the Hepatitis C Trust have campaigned for years. A more effective way of screening to find these people with hepatitis C. And then here we are after one recommendation, almost a full year down the line, and that one recommendation still hasn't been implemented. Time is something that's short for people with hepatitis C.
Any other members on this theme of the process and inquiry? Malcolm? Come back to you, Richard, if you're going to develop your theme.
There's something else I want to ask about, but I'll just stick to this at the moment. I was struck, I mean, I'd totally take on board what you've said, and I understand your concerns about what happened in the inquiry process. In the Haemophilia Scotland submission, it goes through the different expectations, and I was quite interested in expectations 2 and 4. And in expectation 2, you do seem to say that the Penrose Inquiry had been reasonably successful at documenting the events of the disaster. And then in expectation 4, you were concerned because there was no criticism or apportionment of blame. But just on the first point, I mean, would everybody agree with that in terms of documenting the events? Was there anything there that you thought was inaccurate or was part of your concern that certain things were omitted and not dealt with, such as the issue of medical records? But in terms of what is there, your comment does seem to suggest that you're quite happy with that, or is that an overstatement?
No.
Just a minute, Mr. Ray. I'm going to ask if there's any other... is there any other questions on this theme about the inquiry and its outcomes? No. Mr. Wright.
Okay. Given the time that was taken, there was a very substantial body of evidence collected. Much of it, I think, was new evidence that we hadn't been aware of before. And I think it was well over 100,000 documents that they secured and looked at, that the inquiry team examined, as well as about, I think it was 89 days of oral hearings. So obviously they gathered a lot of facts together. Whether they actually then were able to find some explanation for those facts was an entirely different matter. If you read the report of the Penrose Inquiry, you'll find that the term could appears very regularly throughout the report. In the chairman's view, these steps could have been taken rather than should have been taken. In other words, he gathered a body of evidence on much of the story. There was considerable amounts of the story that he didn't explain, such as what happened in relation to, for example, medical records, why it was that UK civil servants attempted to render Crown immunity, which is an extremely savage tool to use against anybody who wants to look into the matter. It was very clear that UK civil servants at the time when they attempted to render Crown immunity were feeling highly insecure about their position. And there was no examination of that particular issue, for example. It does indicate, and however, an insecurity in the government's part. As Philip has alluded to earlier, there was no evidence taken from, for example, Dr. David Owen. In fact, on the day when the report was released, we had a former retired civil servant, phone us up because he'd been concerned about the manner in which the issue had been dealt with. So I think the answer to your question is we didn't get the complete picture. However, we got a much bigger picture than we previously had. And there was not a great deal of judgment exercised, I think, is the point, having put together that body of evidence. There was no set of conclusions, and there was only one single recommendation, which does seem extremely odd, given the cost of the whole exercise and the time involved.
Mr. Dolan?
I feel far more strongly about the fact that during this 6 years of period of time, or whatever length of time it's been, or the year or so at Penrose, listened to stuff that you didn't hear from victims. How can you actually deal with something when the actual people affected have not been heard there? And as I said, there are hundreds and hundreds of stories, a number of people who wanted to give evidence and were dismissed. Granted, all right, you can't go on forever, but the fact is that people did not get an opportunity. He didn't. If, for instance, I had been given an opportunity to give evidence, it would have been an opportunity for the Penrose Inquiry's legal team to question me, or equally for the team representing people with hepatitis C, for their team to question it. But that wasn't there. Some of the evidence that was given, even by the experts there, were found wanting. You know, for instance, the expert witness, very much on the very first day, the hepatologist spoke about the first two cases, came up with a chart which says that Mr. X had a reading of, say, 100 on the score charge. And the expert witness said, that's a sign that he's a heavy drinker. I had to point out to counsel that you don't get hepatitis C from being a heavy drinker. You get cirrhosis from being a heavy drinker. There. They called the next witnesses with a case of a religious minister, who in fact didn't touch alcohol or anything at all, and he had a score of 150, taking its score. I'm using these figures. But it reminds me of going back to the days of old when somebody said, all men and all dogs are hairy. Now, all it needed was one of you to come along and produce a non-hairy dog, and the whole argument is defeated. And in that case, you know, obviously that expert witness was giving evidence, and his expert views, and he's also with an advisor to the Skipton Fund, his evidence was, credibility was questionable. And I think, my whole concern is about the fact of hearing from people. If I go to the doctor, the doctor will listen, will take notes, and then base a diagnosis on what they have heard, etc., or take some other action. But that opportunity wasn't afforded to us, and I think it's a waste of £12 million there. And as it's been said somewhere else, that notes were taken. What was in that report could have been done by somebody who was not a judge, somebody who was good at taking shorthand, and that's virtually what the report seemed to me was about, someone taking notes and wasting a lot of money. So, and I don't know why all these lawyers and everybody else were there if, in fact, they weren't going to speak for us.
Yeah. Richard, will you take us on, I hope?
Yes, aye. Thank you, Convener. And Mr Dolan, thank you for sharing with us your experience. And sadly, you know, it's all too often I'm hearing the same from other sufferers. Can I move on, Convener, by asking, was it a weakness that the Penrose Inquiry didn't seek to apportion blame or establish liability, again, meeting many of the sufferers? That's one of the points that have been put to me over the years. No blame, no liability, no one was basically put in the dock, if I can use that word, for this inquiry. So can I ask the witnesses in regard to
Mr.
that?
Mr. Dolan.
Yeah, I think absolutely correct. There was an inquiry about BSE many years ago in England, and it was chaired by a Scottish judge, in fact. And at the end of that one, the inquiry came out and said they blamed the chief medical officer for England, and they blamed the chief civil servant for this, and named people. In Ireland, when they had an inquiry, the two senior people from the blood transfusion were named. I think you're absolutely correct that somebody should have done this there and proportion blame, because, you know, it wasn't the victim's fault. They went to hospital caring, you know, haemophilia. But a lot of our members, and I think two-thirds of the numbers involved, are people who got blood transfusions. They went into hospital looking to be cared for, and they came out suddenly finding they have a life-threatening condition. So I think there was an opportunity. Someone should be proportionate. And I think it goes back, and whether it's doctors or not, but I think when we were taking information, getting Mr. Chisholm, when he was health minister, allowed for people to get their medical records. And people started phoning me up saying, I've got my medical records, but the batch numbers are missing. I thought, well, maybe that's a bad administration at that hospital. But given I was dealing with people in all five hospitals in Scotland dealing with haemophilia, the same story was coming from that. So it wasn't just a consultant somewhere. That had to come from somewhere in central government, that that information wasn't around. So the finger isn't necessarily just at the consultants, because most of us, as people with haemophilia or people who've got hepatitis, have great respect and got on well with doctors. We spent lots of time in their company, etc. And I do think is that had to be a decision made in some mysterious place in wherever it was.
Mr. Wright.
Well, I think the question simply illustrates the shortcomings in the inquiry system that I've alluded to earlier. If we look at a number of inquiries, I understand that the former First Minister has recently commented on this in relation to the Chilcot inquiry, where there may well be indications of seeking to avoid apportioning blame. And similarly with the Taylor inquiry in Hillsborough, that we really do have to look at what we want out of the inquiry system. Sadly, I would agree that where blame should be apportioned, perhaps it should. However, if we're going to maintain an inquiry system where we do that, we have to expect that witnesses may well adopt defensive rather than reflective positions in giving evidence, which means that we're into a very adversarial position in conducting an inquiry. So it depends what you want an inquiry to achieve. Do you want to learn lessons? Do you want to apportion blame? Do you want to learn, you know, improve current practice. Unfortunately, one of the difficulties we've had in the case of this particular inquiry was it was held so much later than the damage was actually initially done that many of the witnesses had actually passed away. And I'm not just talking about, unfortunately, our own folk. We're actually talking about some of the so-called expert witnesses as well. So I think we need to look very fundamentally at the inquiry system. And I think it's an extremely valid question, but I think it's not simply just about apportioning blame. I think we have to look at what we want out of the inquiry system as a whole. And I noticed that, Mr. Chisholm, you raised the expectations 2 and 4. I'd add that in terms of expectation 3, that those would get their day in court, that Phillips raised. I think the Penrose inquiry, frankly, is increasingly being seen in the same manner that the Taylor inquiry was seen in Hillsborough, that families were dismissed in the case of the Hillsborough inquiry. Years on, finally, we had a panel which was set up in Liverpool, where finally families were actually given the opportunity to relate their stories and to actually be able to express their concerns. And that has, of course, led to an altogether different outcome to that there was to Taylor. Now, I see a lot of parallels between what's happened with Penrose and what happened with the Taylor inquiry, which, of course, has now been pretty much recognised as a highly controversial outcome. So all I would add is that really, in future, we need to look at the purposes of an inquiry. I think the position that was adopted by Lord Penrose as chairman was very defensive of so-called suffering victims. And some of us would have been prepared to stand up and be counted, to give our names. That didn't happen. The 13 people who did appear as witnesses, apart from the fatal accident victims, were all given pseudonyms. Now, if I'd been one of those individuals, I would have been quite prepared personally to stand up and be counted, just as the expert witnesses were. And it was very much a them and us, that there were professional opinions who were exposed to taking the oath and giving evidence, whereas the evidence that I think patients were given was somewhat dismissive. It was almost references were made, for example, to alcohol. A lot of assumptions were made about the consumption of alcohol amongst those who died from hepatitis C. The only way, for example, that you can in fact actually establish how much alcohol someone's consuming is to be with that individual every moment of every day. And doctors did, particularly in the west of Scotland, often on death certificates, make assumptions about alcohol. Now, death certificates have been improved since this disaster took place. But that's why I'm saying there's a whole number of approaches, I think, that need to be taken to looking at both the inquiry system, but also in following this inquiry up.
Mr. Wright, do you want to add anything? No. Richard, you've got a third and final question, if we can move us on. Dennis.
I'll give way to you, Dennis.
Thank you very much. Just a quick supplementary, convener. With regard to the death certificates, if I'm hearing you correct, you're saying the cause of death would have been something other than a hepatitis C or whatever, because of, you know, there was maybe a person had been thought that someone maybe had abused alcohol. But now, with the death certificates, we've got a much better system of recording. So are you content with the new format of death certificates? And do you think that is going to be an improvement in terms of saying, well, these are the facts in terms of the causal aspect of someone's death? Mr. Wright.
I think there have been some improvements made in that previously anybody could write a death certificate who was medically qualified. I think the legacy, however, for us has been that it's caused considerable difficulties. To be honest, that's a matter that I'm only aware of in a degree of detail, and I think I would have to write back to you further on that, Mr. Robertson, in terms of just how we would view it.
Ms. Wright?
Just a follow on there from the death certificate thing. I think we'll find that many deaths that were actually attributable to hepatitis C have been attributed to other things. In the years since hepatitis C was known about, the evidence has come out about other areas apart from the liver which are affected. So you have people who've died from cardiovascular disease, stroke, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, where hepatitis C will not be on the death certificate. So I think the true picture of the number of deaths attributed to hepatitis C is actually a lot lower than it should be.
Yes.
Yeah.
Could I follow up on that, please?
Yes, but taking time from some of the other.
And it does bring us on to the next stage, Chairman, in relation to financial recognition. There is a surprising frequency of death from cerebral brain hemorrhage recorded on death certificates. Now, at present, stage two victims. Many victims died at what's called stage one with respect to financial recognition, but they died of cerebral brain hemorrhage. The most famous of all, of course, being Anita Roddick, who founded the Hepatitis C Trust. And it's a very common occurrence on death certificates that cerebral brain hemorrhage arises. Now, the problem that we've got is the medical input here in terms of relating cerebral brain hemorrhage to hepatitis C. And of course, we've got the difficulty in the case of haemophilia that cerebral brain hemorrhage, the possibility of it, has also risen for people with bleeding disorders. Nevertheless, by having hepatitis C, it would appear that there is an increased risk of cerebral brain hemorrhage. But at the moment, with respect to financial recognition, that is not recognised. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, some of that's reflected in the written evidence, of course, but it's good to get it on the record. Mr. Dolan,
I want to pick up one particular point, was that there, during the inquiry, it's going back to the expert, when it's coming in and saying, and remembers, three or four doctors all close together giving evidence, were asked about a period during the 1970s, 1980s, about talking about hepatitis and all the rest of it. All three of them said in their evidence, I do not recall. It's in my own statement here, they don't recall. Now, may not recall, but a few minutes later, they could recall 10 years previous to that and 10 years afterwards. And what I would say is every person, whether it's a person with haemophilia or a blood transfusion, will remember the day, the hour, etc., when they were told that they had hepatitis C, and the impact that had on them, the impact it has on families and all the rest of it. And people, and it's not just about hepatitis, any time if you're told bad news, you will remember it very clearly. You may not understand what you've been told, but you will remember, I've been told. And people, so I think that for people, for that sort of statement to come in, I find it surprising. Maybe they had a loss of memory on that particular day, but I would suggest is that when I was told, I know when it was, I know the day. I suppose maybe at the age I am, I remember Second World War being declared. I was sitting in the garden, I was about 3 years of age at that time. But the things you will remember clearly there.
Richard, you've got a final question.
Final question. Convener, can I say that I've been involved in this the last number of years, and last year I had the opportunity to go and see the play Factor 9, which was very emotional, very heart-hitting, and conveyed to me the effect that this has had on many sufferers. And Ms. Wright, can I also say that, yes, more than 30 years that people have suffered this rather than the years that I've mentioned earlier. Last night in social media, many people were discussing this committee meeting today. And one of the points that came out, and I promised on the media I would ask, and I may be jumping ahead, Convener, and I apologise if I am, a Scottish settlement for financial support, and Bill Wright spoke on it. People want closure on this now, and I'm not going to put a figure on people's lives, and I'm not going to put a figure on, and that's for, I know that we have, you've got members, and I'm sure that you all are members of the Contaminated Blood Financial Support Review Group, which has been established, and I have to pay compliment to the Cabinet Secretary for what she's done in the last number of months, and also to the apology that the Scottish Government, First Minister and the Cabinet Secretary gave to all sufferers and when Penrose came out. But the group's looking at recommendations. I don't want anyone to give me figures, but basically what closure? Many people out there want closure now. We've had the inquiry. A lot of people called it a whitewash. A lot of people now say, well, enough's enough. We've suffered this for the last 30 years, the last 17 years. You've now came to recognise that we have a legitimate claim. What, in your view, would be, and I don't want to preempt other members' questions, but what would your view be to get a closure on, a rightful closure on what people have suffered in the last number of years?
A rightful closure is a good start. What would be a rightful closure?
That's a very difficult question, because for every individual involved, it's going to be something different. Some people, frankly, it's not money that matters. For many people, the First Minister's apology, the Health Minister's, and also the Scottish National Blood Transfusion Service's apology meant a great deal. So that, over the last year, we've made considerable progress. In the case of haemophilia, there's been considerable progress made as well, because we now have a National Haemophilia Committee set up in order to avoid the circumstances that happened 30-odd years ago, where patient groups will be much more closely involved in the way that haemophilia treatment and support is exercised. So there have been quite a number of steps taken. The big question, of course, for many people is that of financial recognition. And I use that term quite advisedly, because it was a term that was drawn in during the course of the production of this report by a legal official from the government. And it's a term that we can live with, because if we go down the route of legal compensation, then this story will continue for years and years and years much further. Now, we don't want that. We want, in terms of closure, or as near to closure as possible, to try and get money to people as soon as possible. Now, every different individual will have different ideas on what the correct amount of money is. And if we'd gone down the route of looking at each individual and treating their case on a case-by-case basis, then, as in Ireland, we would wait another 10 years. 10 years on in Ireland, there are still cases being argued over in the courts. We don't want that. We want to get money to people tomorrow. We're aware of circumstances where there are families where it's likely that the infected partner will die, and they want to be able to pass away in the knowledge that they're widows. And I must impress upon you the need for urgency here, that their widows are properly looked after, because the widows in this story have been treated shoddily, really, really shoddily. And I have spent a great deal of time sitting. I spent 5.5 hours with one widow recently. in terms of how shoddily the current arrangements are. And I must impress upon you in the strongest possible terms not to obstruct this process, but to ensure that those that have lost loved ones don't have to wait another 17 years to get justice. And my request to you, and I want to impress upon you in the strongest possible terms, that we need government to move on this, to make an early announcement so that the circumstances in which those people who are in fear for their partners' lives, that they, the partners at least know that when they pass on, there will be some sound financial support for the people that will be left behind. I'm sorry, Chairman, but it's a matter that is very deep to my heart.
Ms. Wright.
I think that the recommendations that the review group have made will go a long way to beginning the end for a lot of people. One of the big things for me was this silly stage one, stage two, and the number of people at stage one who have died who are unable to work because of these other medical issues that are obviously now, the evidence is there, they are caused by their hepatitis C. It's unrecognised, they get no help. And we want to pursue that and widening this the criteria for this skipped in stage two, where more people will be able to access an income and all the other, if you could call them, benefits of having their health impact recognised about the hepatitis C. And even small things like the stigma. At the public meeting I went up to in Perth, I spoke to one gentleman and he was in his third generation of keeping a secret. He had had hepatitis C from a blood transfusion. Him and his wife had kept it from their son while he was growing up. The son had now grown up and knew all about what happened to his father, but now the son had a son and the family were back to the situation once again, trying to keep this horrendous secret and the stigma away from their third generation.
Mr. Dolan.
Yeah, Bill's right to say that some people don't necessarily want some money. They want an explanation why this happened. And that, we've said all along, is the case. But where I disagree, and you've got my note of dissent from the Scottish Infected Blood Forum, which represent probably two-thirds of the people who've got hepatitis C, according to Lord Penrose's figures, whether you believe in statistics at all. But the fact is that the concern that was around was the fact that in stage one and stage two, which we believe should not exist, it sort of splits people up. But in terms of a lot of people who are in stage one are very, very ill. In the document I've sent you put around earlier, this thing here, you'll read at your leisure tomorrow or later on, the stories of people, and it talks about the different type of experiences people have got. And I have one here which maybe depicts a lady, it's about her story, what the impact it had, her husband, who had haemophilia, died, and the impact it has had on the total fact of her family. Just the basic things there, saying, you know, if he'd been alive, he would have walked my daughter down the aisle last year. These are the sort of things which is a wider part of a family. And I hope that some of you tomorrow night will be able to come to the event that we're holding in this building tomorrow night, and where the stories will be told. We'll be told on the video film where people have appeared telling their own story about this. There's also ones which came from the scoping exercise, people telling what actually happened to them. You know, I'm one of these people that don't get emotive, etc., but I feel as much of anything else. But the fact that you differentiate between one person because they happen to be deemed to be in stage one and somebody who's in stage two. I have nothing against people in getting increased monies, etc., in stage two. But equally, it is the difference between one and another, where somebody's circumstances are absolutely appear to be the same. They still have the same family. They can't talk about it and all the rest of it. And these are important, I think, there. And the fact that the review group did come out with a particular view, and that's why we put in the dissent thing, but equally why we put in the commentary, because following the review group, a report came out, was published, but only, it was only recently I discovered that within that report, the 10-page commentary we put in was views of people going through all the meetings that took place had been left out. And I understand the reason it was left out, that some parties who were involved with a review group had wanted it sort of silenced, didn't want it to be published. It seemed to be censored. I don't know which parties it was, but I do know that some people on that group, because an emphasis was put on stage two to get money, and we have nothing against that financially, but the fact is that the majority of people are in stage one, and they will those who are seeking financially will get nothing. You know, it doesn't matter.
I suppose that, you know, we get into these situations as you expect in the committee all of the time. In fact, we'll be speaking on some things this week where we'll express a view of the majority and a view of the minority. And in reading some of the background papers to this, there are certain differences with a minority and a majority. I've heard that reflected today. I'm just trying to develop this theme, so I'll give you an opportunity to come in. But we spoke about closure. For some people, without apportioning that blame and real understanding of what happened, there can be no closure. For some people, the financial arrangements, generous or ungenerous, that will be apportioned, will not satisfy everyone. There'll be, issues about, I think the points are well made, in regards to the limitations of who any support would be provided to, not simply Hep C, but some of the other conditions that you mentioned earlier, which is still something that's to be argued in one, as an observation, not being an expert. I wonder, I suppose the follow-up question after all of that context is, what issues do we believe that we can get a majority of opinion from those who have been involved in this for far too long? Do they currently agree? We know that financial support and the financial arrangements is a priority at this stage. That comes through. So everybody's agreed with that. So we can get closure on that. And how would we get closure on the financial matters before we move to some of these other issues that are still outstanding? Yes, Mr. Dolan.
I agree with you there. I think your opening remarks saying that obviously in committees there are agreements and disagreements, but at least in the Scottish Parliament, the openness that those who dissent, their views are at least recorded, which has not been recorded in the report that came from the review group, even though we put in. In terms of closure, some people certainly don't want anything, but the fact is that the gap between what financial arrangements is being suggested for those in stage one and those in stage two is, I'm not saying it is ideal, but it is absolute, the width and distance between what people get and people are going to die. There was suggested to me, put to me recently, there's new treatment out for hepatitis C.
Yes.
And there's some folk will say, that because of it, they're cleared. But we know that from the Ebola case of a nurse in Lanarkshire that was told she was cleared, and we know from talking to other people, yes, this new drug is cleared, but it still is resident somewhere within the body, so it isn't clear. But we've certainly got the issue that those people who are in stage two or stage one people, all that are being offered was in 2004, Mr. Chisholm, when he was health secretary in this parliament, he made an ex gratia payment, which he and I were on opposite sides of the table disagreeing on this, but he made an ex gratia payment, which I was glad it forced a Westminster government to follow suit. So at least we'll do things right here. But we have argued that the Lord Ross recommended £50,000 back in 2003, and that was never reached. What the recommendation in the stage one at the moment with his review group is that an extra £30,000 be given to people in stage one who got £20,000 some in 2002, 2003, or around about that period of time, 10 years ago, that the £30,000 would only bring them up to what Lord Ross recommended in 2003. Yeah. And Lord Ross' recommendation was that it would be that would be for the fact that people have been harmed by the fact of hepatitis C. So the recommendation really that's coming through from a review group is only to go by what was recommended some 10 plus years ago. While it's good to know that the people in stage two are going to get considerably more money. It may not be enough, but it will get considerably more money. But the fact is, if you take two people sitting together, one is in stage one, one is stage two, and they see it get some financial thing, it at least helps them to get on with their life in that sense. The other person gets nothing, and they're destroyed. One later, you know, people don't know how they're going to bury their loved one whenever they die because they don't have any money. The money they got.
It is a complex set of arrangements, isn't it, as well, which is another thing in terms of the background paper. Mr. Wright, do you have a comment on that? And then I'll go.
The stage one, stage two breakdown is a difficulty because, you know, we couldn't start when the review group started its work, it wasn't starting with a blank sheet. And we were in effect, in terms of the breakdown between stage one and stage two, having to operate on the basis of what was originally the Ross recommendation to you, Mr. Chisholm, when you were minister. And Philip was actually on the Ross committee that made that recommendation of the breakdown between stage one and stage two. Now, of course, medical understanding has moved on since then, and Petra's better positioned than I to talk about the extra hepatic effects. However, we didn't have the advantage of medical representation on the financial review group. And if there's any weakness in the review that we conducted, I'd suggest it was possibly that. However, nevertheless, we do not want to go back to a blank sheet here because we think it's better for everyone to have at least £30,000 in their bank account as a result of this review, which would happen if the recommendations are followed. I should also make the point that £30,000 is by no means a ceiling under the proposals as recommended. If you look at recommendation four, proposal for support and assistance grants, it's actually proposed to increase the amount of, shall we say, flexibility in terms of, for example, funeral costs or whatever that can actually be drawn upon, whether you're stage two, stage one, stage two, or widows or whatever. I think it's worth recognising what hasn't been mentioned so far, that there were 60 people who were infected with HIV by this disaster. They were both infected with HIV and hepatitis C. 40 of those died. And that particular element of this, I think, has got somewhat forgotten in this whole story, in that they had a double whammy and were particularly keen that the HIV provisions are brought up to Scotland, because at present the administration of all these schemes is, of course, down south. The Macfarlane Trust, there's no Scottish representation whatsoever, and we believe that the whole thing needs to be administered from within Scotland. And, of course, with HIV, if HIV is included in that, then we're able to do that. But the reason that the Hepatitis C Trust and we supported the report was that we did build in some flexibility. If you look at the fourth bullet point of Proposal 5, further work, that thresholds for Stage 1 and Stage 2 of the Skipton Fund should be subject of a specific evidence-based review. Now, that could encompass many of the concerns that Philip's raising here. In terms of these extra hepatic effects. And I think, Petra, you're probably better qualified than I, but we would like to draw in medical representation to that. There are considerations such as fatigue, which is an extremely common theme throughout those affected with hepatitis C, but it's very difficult to actually then provide evidence on, because, of course, it's self-reported, rather than through a blood sample or whatever. And we need to find a way through that in terms of those who, for example, who are in stage one have no longer been able to work because of the impacts of fatigue. But as far as the sort of evidence it states is that they would, you know, they just simply don't have the energy to go to work every day.
I'm going to relate this back to my first involvement with hepatitis C when I was first diagnosed, because my biggest symptom was my memory seemed to have disappeared. Now, I'm going back to 2006 now, one of the first conferences that I attended, and we were shown some new magnetic resonance imaging scans of brains of people with hepatitis C, and you could see where the brain damage had occurred. Hepatitis C at that time was known to cross the brain-blood barrier. They had found hepatitis C active virus within the brain on post-mortem. One of the first things I learned about it was that it was a systemic disease affecting multi-organs around the body. But initially, the liver cirrhosis and the liver damage was the first thing that was recognised, and that seems to have taken precedence throughout. Maybe hepatitis C is actually an incorrect name for it, because it relates to the liver too much. So that was my first involvement, because to find that I wasn't actually going mad or had early Alzheimer's, that it was because of the hepatitis C that my memory had escaped me. It was very disturbing for me not to be able to remember things. The other thing that's gone on for a long time, as Bill mentioned, was Dame Anita Roddick passing not long after she was diagnosed with a cerebral haemorrhage. In the last sort of year or so, there's lots of evidence coming out now about the various things that are now attributed or linked to hepatitis C. Cardiovascular disease, lymphoma, stroke, diabetes, all things that we're concerned about here in Scotland anyway. The other things are that the kidneys can be affected. Natalie Cole had a kidney transplant as a result of her hepatitis C. And all this range of things seems to be largely ignored in some respects by the medical profession. I've heard of people going along to their doctor after being successfully cured of their hepatitis C infection, but these things still go on. And one lady said that her GP had said, I don't know, your hepatitis C is cured, but she's still suffering from these other things as well. And I think the latest framework published by the Scottish Government, the latest sexual health and bloodborne virus framework for the next 5 years, the priority areas that they have listed as in terms of being treated for hepatitis C, getting access to these new drugs, it's patients with F3, F4 hepatic fibrosis, and then and or patients with severe extrahepatic manifestations of hepatitis C, and also patients with significant psychosocial morbidity as a consequence of hepatitis C. So already we're seeing some recognition within the medical profession of the other aspects and the other health issues that hepatitis C can bring. And I really feel that once we reconvene the group and can take a deeper look at these issues, it will help not only the people in this disaster, but also the thousands of others out there who got hepatitis C, possibly by other means. We could go a long way to helping these people's lives.
Thanks for that. I've got a couple of committee members, Malcolm and Rhoda, if anyone else. Dennis is wanting in as well. Malcolm.
Just wanted to ask Philip Dolan, so I completely understand his position. Is your main concern about the recommendation about the level, the £50,000 level, or have you still got issues about whether there should be a stage one and stage two, or is it mainly the initial? Or?
I think basically the people were saying that it's a difference between stage one and stage two, and many of the members don't feel there should be a stage one and stage two. There may be some way of putting tiers of where a payment comes in, but I think the level of payment that people will be offered is seen as derisive, because many people started along this road feel at the end of all of this thing and Penrose and that they are no worse than what they would have been if in 2004 the recommendation of Ross had been implemented. So the majority of people would only ever get to what Lord Ross recommended. I know there were difficulties in your time and difficulties elsewhere, but I think a lot of people want an explanation. They want some support for people who've been affected. They want some... setting up of the Scottish Infected Blood Forum created an opportunity for the first time for people who had blood transfusions, who had hepatitis C. Haemophilia have been around for a long time, and therefore, as an organisation, people knew about hepatitis and got there. People who got infected with a blood transfusion felt stigmatised, felt they could not talk to anybody about it. You know, one of her members, who was a guidance teacher in a big school, said that she was first diagnosed as having ME, then she was told she had hepatitis C. She felt unable to go and talk to her fellow teachers because they'd assume she was a drug addict. You know, that's where the assumption comes in. And there's lots and lots of that type of thing there. I think, perhaps to answer the question, Malcolm, is I would think that while a number of people aren't interested in the money, the majority of people are interested in money. And my experience in when going through the campaigning, etc., being told, oh, you shouldn't be... I remember a doctor I used to sit in tribunals with saying, oh, you shouldn't be campaigning at this. Doctors are good people who don't make mistakes, etc. That's fine. But when Mr Chisholm announced the ex gratio payment, 7 o'clock that night, I got a phone call from the same doctor saying, how does my cousin get money there? No one had ever worked this out. His cousin probably would spend 20,000 in the casino in one night, but when an ex gratio payment was made, it didn't differentiate between the rich and the poor. People got what a recognition in terms of it. So in terms of, I do think it's the biggest thing is a gulf between stage one and stage two, and if some sort of way could be done to at least take away from having stage one and stage two and have some system where people could get financially. Because I'm sure a lot of people who are currently in stage two recognise the difficulties being experienced in people who have not, by chance, had a doctor to come down and saying you are now in stage two. So, and because they're having all the effects that Petra has spoken about, they're suffering from a whole range of illnesses, etc., which are probably associated with having hepatitis, but they just haven't developed cirrhosis to the level.
Ms. Wright, do you want to come in?
We have members in stage one, stage two, and what's called stage zero. Stage zero is where people have applied to the Skipton Fund for £20,000 funding and been refused because their medical records were lost. In other words, any record of them either having received a blood transfusion, because we actually do have members who have had blood transfusions as well. I think coming down to the point here and going back to what I said earlier about we are where we are in terms of what we inherited, we looked at the Canadian system, which has six stages. I think my colleague, Dan Farthing, our chief executive, and I did have some informal discussions with government officials about perhaps looking at a stage 1A or whatever in order to bridge that gulf. But I think our concern here is that if we start to rewrite these proposals that have come from this group, we will be a year on, no further forward, there will be further deaths, there will be people who will have been not have received £30,000 perhaps before the election that they might do. We don't know when we're going to get this £30,000 to people. We think it's far better that we get that money in. They've got access to the new support and grant fund, which is going to take some time to establish. And I think Petra mentioned here about there's further work to be done. This is by no means the end of the story, but there is some of this in this report that can be acted upon immediately. And that's my concern. I want to get some money into people's bank accounts. There is an opportunity here to do that. And I think it's very important to put this into context in terms of the situation within the wider UK. You may well be aware that the UK government announced a further £100 million to be dedicated towards this particular issue for the rest of the UK. We've had a brief look at what's being proposed under the consultation there, and it actually does appear that that will also include, our understanding is that that will include the cost of treatment, the new drugs, £60,000 per person. Now that takes a very large chunk of that £100 million out. Last year on March the 25th, on the day that the Penrose report came out, the Prime Minister announced a further £25 million, which on the face of it appeared pretty generous, as an interim payment. I wrote to him and asked him how that was to be distributed and how they'd reached the £25 million figure. I never received a response. Now, I say this in context because on March the 25th last year, Jackson Carlaw, the spokesman for the Conservatives, said that he was personally rather proud of how Scotland had dealt with this issue, in that we set up a group of people who worked with government. We argued, the discussions were very tense at times, they were tense between us at times, but we came up with this report. And I think we need to get, I commend to you this report, we need to get ahead and enact as much of it as we possibly can. The report acknowledges there's further work to be done on the issues that are raised with regard to stage one. And we don't shy away from that. As I say, we have got people with stage one. I've spent time with a stage one widow and seen how unjust the situation has been. But there are hits that we can make here at an early date. And I think we need to get ahead. And I must impress upon you, get ahead and take what action we can, and we engage the medical profession and academics, for example, in exploring these other issues about fatigue and mental health problems that have arisen as a consequence, which I'm sure Petra could comment on.
Yes, please.
Yeah, I was actually going to bring it back round to what would give a good conclusion as well, would be to actually find the people that are still to be found is recommendation. The Hepatitis C Trust are on the short life working group looking at that. Well, we're happy enough, we're getting a bit impatient about it all. For instance, the estimates that there are only 200 people in Scotland who acquired hepatitis C through a blood transfusion pre-1991 who are still to be found. I would actually dispute that number as being extremely low. If we just think of recent history, there was an infection in the Royal Infirmary in Edinburgh in the A&E department. There was an infection in an inpatient in Lanarkshire a couple of years ago. We've had the rogue dentist in Ayrshire. You know, there have been many opportunities in the past other than blood transfusion directly where people may have picked up their infections through NHS treatment. And by introducing some degree of screening across the country, whether it be birth cohort screening, you know, like they do in America, every one of us, a certain age group gets requested to go and have a hepatitis C test, would help a lot. But we don't think that actually spending a lot of time trying to figure out how to find only 200 people will prove to be cost effective and actually find the people that we need to find. We need to look at the whole community, I hope you guys don't mind, of people out there who have hepatitis C and don't know it.
Could I just add to what Petra said? Because I'm on that working group as well. There, I was set up at Look Back under Professor Goldberg. Interesting enough, it's met once. I keep trying to find out when it's going to meet again. But I understand that the difficulty has been that people required to be on it for either doctors from the blood transfusion service, etc., are never available. So therefore, the group had been appointed way back at the same time as the review group, both set up at the same time. But a year on, we're no further forward. So it's quite interesting to see that. But it's come to meetings like this, I carry various documents, and I have a letter back, I think about the 80s, etc., from the senior persons in blood transfusion and the Scottish office, writing saying we have to have a look back. But that letter is there. It seems to have not got anywhere since in those 30 odd years, etc. You can see it later if you want, but that's just to go on what Petra was saying.
You mentioned the there was a figure of about 200 still not identified. Are you aware how they would identify it would be 200? Why did they come up with a nice round number like that?
I've actually got no idea at all where these numbers come from. You know, it just seems like a ridiculous number.
Have you collectively done any work, about estimating what that number was more likely to be?
Not in particular. But you know what I'm referring to is that there are a lot of people who applied to Skipton who were refused because they didn't have enough evidence. There are also a lot of people out there recorded by Health Protection Scotland. And the criteria for transmission route is don't know. You know, I just feel that sometimes we can be too narrow in our search criteria and that it would be more cost effective to cast a wider net in the hope of helping more people. You know, why... This always amuses some people because I always relate it to watching Casualty or Holby City. You know, when you go in there, people get brought into A&E and it's UFDs, LFDs, you know, whatever else. Hepatitis. Why not just tag it on? Why make it different? Make it a normal part of healthcare to test for it. The majority of people out there, particularly women who have had babies, will say, I can't have that because I've been tested for it. And you go, no, you haven't. You will automatically be tested for HIV and hepatitis B, but you won't be tested for hepatitis C unless you're a known drug addict or you come from another high-risk area, say a Pakistan or something like that. It's just there are so many missed opportunities out there to find these people. Do we want to find them?
Just leaving that hanging there. Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Convener. I don't think the witnesses are poles apart in what they want us to see today. Can I move on to another subject, which is to do with tissue samples for research? I think this was an issue that was brought up where there are currently held tissue samples, but the people whose tissue samples they are not aware if their samples are being held and indeed if they are being used for medical research. I want to know your thoughts on that and how easy it would be to identify the people whose samples are being held, because it seems to me, given some of the evidence we've had, that might be easy if they could be identified from research, which seems to be one of the concerns, and how you would go about getting permission to use that and informing people if that's held.
Yes, Mr. Dolan.
It's an interesting question. I, for 17 years, no, 12 years, was vice chairman of the Research and Ethics Committee for the Primary Care Trust of Glasgow there. And so when, and I also have at various times for haemophilia, say we want to take something for research. And I stick to what the Helsinki Agreement was, that when a sample is taken from you for research, it's for that specific particular topic at that time. But you have to go back to the person to seek their permission if you want to use that specimen, a sample, for some other reason. And I think that I recall when, way back when, various researches were done, certainly in Glasgow, in the red light district, the street workers were being tested. And the question cropped up, you know, they were being tested anonymously, but there still was a question that if they'd been tested there at some time at a later date, somebody put in for insurance, etc., and they don't mention it, they suddenly find, if they suddenly marry a millionaire and they wanted some money, etc., suddenly find they can no longer, they're not getting anything because insurance companies will sure as fate find out a reason for not paying. But I think that the basis is, the answer I would say is that if anybody gave us, use myself, if I give a specimen for something, I give it for that particular thing, and I would not want it used for anything else unless I was asked that permission. It may well be I would be quite happy to do so, but I don't think under the original thing of ethics was that you give agreement and sign for a particular test or survey that's being done, but I would have reservations. This is a personal viewpoint, and it would be the view that was being held at that time while I was involved with the Ethics Committee.
Anyone else in response to the order?
I'm a wee bit reluctant to enter into that because it's beyond my technical expertise in terms of the way that these samples are presently administered. Could you maybe enlarge a wee bit on an example?
Well, my understanding is that there are samples held and that they could be used for research, but they are anonymised. So the excuse given is that they can't track back to who they belong to. And this is going back historically. And there's concerns that people living have samples that are being held and may be used for research. And I suppose they need to know if that's the case and give their informed consent if that's happening.
Yes, I mean, I can think of instances where, for example, with CJD, that might be a concern. Because, of course, unfortunately, the haemophilia community, as well as having been victims of hepatitis C and HIV, were informed in the 90s that there was the possibility of exposure to CJD. That was at a very discrete period of time over a couple of years. Because previously CJD had only been thought the passage through beef, but it did appear that because of the concentrates it might also have been passed through blood products. I think there's a big ethical question in that, because in Scotland
you know, like any Western country, developed country, research is needed. It's the medical ethics that we need to get right. And I think we need to actually have to look at the actual detail of that. On blood, certainly, we would say that anybody who is giving a blood sample, if it was to be used for research purposes, we would have to be made well aware what the research purposes might be for and whether or not they wanted to be informed of the outcome. That is a general rule. I don't know what, I have to confess, I don't know what the exact written ethical rules in that are.
Okay. Dennis Roberts.
Scottish Government have agreed to fund the Scottish Infected Blood Forum and Haemophilia Scotland for the next 3 years. Do you have a common purpose in terms of what you'll be doing over the next 3 years? And do you expect that there may be recurring funding after that?
Obviously, the money has been given. We've actually just, although it was announced several months ago, the money's actually just come into our bank, and I think it may be in our bank this weekend or there, but it hasn't reached us. We have been soldiering on my superannuation and various other people's donations. But I do have a list of receipts, etc., which may go to it. But the main purpose of the Scottish Infected Blood Forum has been very much in to create the forum where people came to discuss. People never, particularly blood transfusion people, have never had an opportunity to talk to somebody else who had hepatitis C. And it's amazing how having this forum, the opportunity to meet and discuss and share things and be supportive to each other. And in this document you've got here today, you'll probably find that a number of people who've given their stories and will be speaking of them on television on the film tomorrow night have told what the advantage and of having been an opportunity to go to the Scottish Infected Blood Forum. So the advantage of that is that at the moment, obviously, we publish documents and give support to people, and my phone rings regularly. We are hoping to put in place a part-time worker in the same way as Dan Farthing does to the Haemophilia Scotland. I think the purpose of it... I don't know whether there's something else you wanted to...
I'm just wondering, I mean, obviously you've stated it is a support forum, which is excellent in terms of providing support. I dare say you provide appropriate information and advice. I'm just wondering if there's a common aim between both organisations in working together and a common cause, in a sense, to keep the awareness there, but to look at appropriate outcomes.
I think the answer is we obviously have been as we're here today because we've been campaigning for the help and support to people in terms financially and otherwise, and for counselling, for instance, although there are suggestions in the review group that counselling could become available, but the opportunity is to also to improve on the treatment, and there are new treatments around. But again, these treatments, it depends where you are, etc., whether they're made available to you. Because, I know I'm one of these reluctant people who are very wary about going on to new treatments, etc., having lived through a lifetime of getting snake venom way back in my early days to various cryoprecipitate and factor 8, which then gave me hepatitis C, and then products that say that tell me, as mentioned earlier, that that letter coming in saying we know you've received blood from products from somebody who's since died of variant CJD. When I mentioned this in our household, there you know, the best thing for me to do is get a dictionary. All the dictionaries in my house have a bookmark under the letter S where I find sympathy. So it's but in a sense, what the whole purpose, I would say, is to try and get the improved treatment. At the end of the day, hopefully, one of these days we'll come back and somebody will find something will cure. But at the moment, this suggestion that, and you'll see it, you may see it in the film, is say a doctor saying that the new treatment you will be cured. But as I said in an earlier day, there's now, you can never guarantee something's a cure because something lying in dormant in the somewhere else in your body and the effect. But we're obviously working to try and improve. We're trying to improve the life of our members and give support to families.
Anyone else? Yes, please.
I was just going to say in that respect, the Hepatitis C Trust, through our patient helpline, we have contact across anyone with hepatitis C can use our services. But we already run a counselling service that's funded by England and Wales for victims of the contaminated blood through, I can't remember, is it Caxton or Skipton or through something like that. So they do have a good understanding of the needs of these people. We also do a couple of health days, you know, just to try and encourage them towards doing treatment as well and explaining the advances that have been made in hepatitis C over the years.
Mr. Wright.
We have a set of objectives that are set out with Oscar, which overlap quite a great deal with those at the Scottish Infected Blood Forum. We don't specifically name either HIV or hepatitis C in those, but for reasons that are obvious, we have a considerable section of our membership and the population that we seek to support who were infected. So yes, there's considerable overlap in the work that we do with both the Scottish Infected Blood Forum and the Hepatitis C Trust, who we've learned a great deal from. And also other organisations like Waverley Care that deal with HIV. I think the implication of the question is how do you get best bang for your buck in terms of the spending of public money? And to a certain extent, we are potentially drawing on the same pot. We can see advantages in the Scottish Infected Blood Forum having a part-time officer because obviously they would be in daily contact with our own office here in Edinburgh, as well as obviously Petra, who administers the Hepatitis C Trust in Scotland. I do think, however, from our own perspective, it's very useful that we have secured some public funding to have people working for us, but we are looking to the future in terms of trying to be more independent. Ultimately, as a charity, we don't want to be dependent on government because, of course, at some stage in the future, we may well wish to be critical of it. There is a balance to be achieved there in relation to funding of all health charities.
Okay. There'll be a discussion about the public funding. How much is it, the public funding of the various bodies, do we know?
Deputy Trust doesn't get anything in Scotland at all.
I think we
Mr. Dolan?
Yeah, the funding we've been given is £25,000 for this year.
Did you not get anything, Mr. Wright? Are you not expecting a cheque in the post this weekend, like Mr. Dolan?
We've already got it.
It's in the bank. It's not in the post. But you're not telling us what it was.
we have an arrangement that we've had £75,000 this year.
Yeah. Okay. It was just to complete the discussion. It wasn't anything other than that.
£75,000, convener, is that for the 3 years? Or is that
this year? This, okay. Until what is it, April the 3rd or something like that. 31st of March,
so
thank you.
So I presume that you welcome the 3 years funding that's been needed.
Yeah.
Okay, is there any other questions from the committee members? No other questions? Can I, it remains for me. Yeah, Mr. Dolan, of course you can have the last word. Indeed, any of the witnesses, if you feel that there are issues that you... We have your written evidence, of course, sure. And that's extensive. But if you wish to mention any of that or feel that there were issues that you expected to be asked or wish to place on the record, please do so. Take the opportunity to do that. I think the Cabinet Secretary we have, Nix, has been delayed a wee bit, so it allows us that opportunity. So, Mr. Dolan.
There's a couple of points there. In our... presentation or paper we put you, we mentioned the fact that on the 4th of March 1998 in the Westminster Parliament there was an adjournment debate about factor 8. This is really to do with the blood and getting a proper ideal blood products, and it was introduced by Roseanne Cunningham at that time, supported by John Swinney and John McCallion, and it was really to point out about a young person in Scotland who had been refused the correct treatment, etc. For your benefit, if you want to read, you will see in this book on page 20 his story. He was the youngest person in Britain to, in fact, be put on a treatment for hepatitis C, which didn't work. He was aged 8 at the time, the youngest ever person at that time. There, so you may want to read it. I'll just draw attention to these ones. There also, there's a story in here about a person who got hepatitis C as a result of it being sexually transmitted by his wife, there, who'd had a blood transfusion before. These things are always seen as rare, but they exist. And for many of the people it's mentioned, and not just in this, the difficulties in getting benefits, getting them stopped, having to get no benefit for months and months and months until they go through various tribunals, etc. The other one's about, one remembers, the stigma at school, where when people heard they had haemophilia, that was fine. But then when the HIV came around, they wanted him removed. And in the classroom, suddenly the head teacher's niece or somebody that happened to be in the same class, and he was moved away so he wouldn't be close to them. That type of story crops up going over. And obviously... the issues. But other, and its impact of these things have the stigma as associated with people, we mentioned it earlier. So it's just to remind you, these are some of the main issues. Because you've got hepatitis C, assumption, it's been mentioned many times already, the fact of tiredness is an impact, the time it takes sometimes to be told you've got hepatitis C, and I make that mention in my early submission that in 1991, I asked a consultant, did I have hepatitis C? I was told, oh, there's nothing to bother about. So I insisted. He says, I went back, got my medical records, and said, oh, I see it. In 1978, we knew you had non-A, non-B, which was the forerunner of hepatitis C. Now, as we mentioned, ethics. Ethically, for someone to be testing someone, they should get your permission. They should also tell you, and they should also inform, because the important part is that you have to make decisions about that can be passed on to your partners, etc. So those are issues which crop up. Others complain in some places it's very difficult to get an appointment with a hepatologist there, even though it's been mentioned. And as was mentioned earlier, being regarded as a junkie or a leper, and these stories come out in here. And in some cases, there's a lack of professional understanding you know, somebody goes up, finds you've got hepatitis C, without reading your case records, a nurse will hand you a box of needles saying you know what to do with them. And of course the person doesn't know what to do because they hadn't been told. And this here will tell you the number of stories of people where marriage has broken up or they've lost their home because of financial things. So these are the practical the issues that the real things
you,
that happen.
You're finishing on, you know, I think the committee would agree, a significant note. This is not about, you know, medical titles. I mean, this is or formulas for compensation or financial. Well, this is about people, and I think you're finishing on that note, mm-hmm. which I think the committee genuinely understand. Many of us have been involved in that journey, not like you were, but I and others, and Malcolm's been mentioned, were on that health committee. Indeed, the cabinet secretary, who is now waiting outside the door, was on that health committee when we first started this long, long journey. But it is, I think, on that note that we conclude this session, that this is about people. We know from our casework, as well as our committee work, we have dealt with many of our constituents who have found themselves in this very frightening situation, and we've all been in a position to help where we could there. Now, the brief is a word for Mr. Wright, and I wouldn't deny Petra a final word. If she wants a final quick word, the Cabinet Secretary is now with us, and we need to proceed.
I would just like to say that we are running out of time. We have spent 30 years waiting for this. I really hope that the Scottish Government will accept our recommendations from the Financial Review Group and at least let us make some kind of forward movement towards finishing this.
I'd like to thank you, Chairman and members, for having us here today. I'm aware that some of you, after a very long period in Parliament and the Health Committee or various health committees, are now retiring. Others may or may not return. I hope that those of you who are here today, having heard this story, may well return, because there is a job to be done in future parliaments in order to ensure that what's recommended here is actually seen through. And I understand you're obviously going into private session to discuss both this evidence and that from the Cabinet Secretary. And I very much hope that you're able to support these recommendations and we can move forward in the manner that you talked about closure. This would be a big step toward that. Thank you.
Thank you. No, I'm sorry, Mr. Dolan, but we're not going into private session. We're going to take evidence now from the Cabinet Secretary and your colleague, and you're welcome to stay in the public gallery. But thank you all for your attendance, the time you've given, the written evidence, and indeed the oral evidence you've presented this morning. Thank you all very much. Thank you. I suspend at this point and allow the next panel to take its place and for me to go a place. Can I now welcome the Cabinet Secretary and officials for the second panel we have this morning. Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing and Sport. Welcome. Gareth Brown, Acting Head of Health Protection Division, Scottish Government, and Professor David Holberg, Health Protection Scotland. Welcome to you all. Can I give the Cabinet Secretary an opportunity to make some opening remarks? And then we'll move to questions.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks for the opportunity to speak to the committee today about the Penrose Inquiry Report. The Penrose Inquiry scrutinised the tragic past events in detail, but since the publication of the report, our focus has been on the future and trying to better support those affected. I've met many of those who have been directly affected over the years, and I continue to meet with key campaigners on a regular basis. It's very clear to me that they face a multitude of physical, mental and social impacts which continue to this day and in many cases will endure for the rest of their lives. For all those infected and their families, there are clearly complex and interacting impacts on overall health, life expectancy, quality of life, mental and emotional well-being and the ability to work. Following the inquiry report publication, both myself and the First Minister apologised on behalf of the Government of Scotland and the NHS in Scotland to everyone who has had to deal with these devastating impacts. And I'd like to reiterate that apology here today. Expressions of sympathy and regret obviously only go so far, and there is an ongoing need for direct support systems, financial and otherwise. Intensive support, including mental health support, if appropriate, needs to be made available for those most severely affected. Lord Penrose's single recommendation was that the Scottish Government should take all reasonable steps to offer a hepatitis C test to anybody who might have been infected before 1991 by a blood transfusion and who has not already been diagnosed. We accepted this recommendation and have considered carefully how to take it forward in the context of a previous look-back exercise in 1995 and awareness-raising campaigns as late as 2008. We established a short life working group chaired by Professor David Goldberg to consider this recommendation further. That group, which involves patient representatives, is modelling the number of people who may be infected and undiagnosed and will consider what further action should be taken. But beyond the work of that group, Scotland has invested significantly in tackling hepatitis C since 2008. We are recognised internationally for what we've done. Anyone can ask to be tested at their GP practice, and the Chief Medical Officer specifically wrote to GPs to encourage testing following the publication of the inquiry report. The other major piece of work is our review of the financial support schemes. We established an independent group with a majority of patient representatives and an independent chair to provide us with recommendations on how patients in Scotland should be supported in the future. Although there was debate and some disagreement among the group members, the group concluded its work late last year and provided me with a report and recommendations. I'm now considering that report and will make an announcement before the end of this parliamentary session. I'm also pleased that we've been able to provide funding to both Haemophilia Scotland and the Scottish Infected Blood Forum to support their advice, advocacy and peer support services. We also funded the Scottish Infected Blood Forum to carry out a scoping exercise to investigate the support needs of those affected, which contributed to the work of the review. We've funded a pilot of additional psychological support for haemophilia patients in Edinburgh involving adults and children. I can also confirm that a national managed clinical network has been established for inherited bleeding disorders involving patients in service decisions and driving best practice and quality improvement. And we continue to ensure access to hepatitis C therapies in Scotland, despite the very high cost of the most effective therapies. And we support NHS boards with around £28 million per year for sexual health and bloodborne virus services. In all of these ways, I think we've shown our commitment to supporting those people affected by this tragedy. And considering how we respond to the recommendations from our review group, I'm optimistic that I'll be able to show that we want to maintain and improve that support into the future. I look forward to answering any questions.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We now move directly to questions, and the first question from Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You've heard quite a lot of the evidence, and it's of no surprise to you that there's some frustration about the Penrose inquiry in itself, the length of time it's taken, and only the one recommendation. In light of that, what discussions have you had with the UK government in terms of the outcomes of Penrose? And I say I welcome the statement that you've made this morning and the support you've provided in financial support and obviously advice to groups. But the UK government and yourselves, I mean, did you have a discussion about the outcome? And if so, could you maybe share that with us?
Well, first of all, obviously, as I'm sure you've heard through the evidence session, obviously, Penrose, it was an independent inquiry, and I accept, as I said at the time, that the outcome of Penrose didn't meet the expectations of many of those affected. I think that's just a fact. But it was independent, and it did, if nothing else, give the opportunity for testimony to be given and for people's experiences to be recorded. Clearly, the recommendation and what Penrose said in his report was as much relevant really for other parts of these islands and potentially internationally as well as it is for Scotland, that we would expect all governments to look at the Penrose inquiry and take from it any lessons for their own systems. In terms of what happened beyond Penrose, we've had probably the most discussions we've had with the UK government have been around the financial provisions. You'll be aware the UK government have just recently made an announcement about the review of their systems. What we've been clear about is that the biggest priority for us is to try and get a better financial set of arrangements into the hands of those who need it most as quickly as possible. Now, there are some practical issues to be addressed. So the systems that deliver the current financial provisions are UK systems, in the main, the Skipton and Caxton funds. The UK government has signalled that they want to change those systems anyway, and we would want to get our own Scottish systems up and running. But meantime, we will require a delivery mechanism for any enhanced financial arrangements. Obviously, we've yet to announce the acceptance of these recommendations, but we would need to have some interim arrangements to be able to get the money into the hands of people as quickly as possible while we set up our own arrangements. But we've been having a very good dialogue at both ministerial level and at official level. Just one final point to say that I was disappointed about the winter fuel payments. I thought that that could have been a quick way of getting some additional resources into the hands of people who, you know, basically feel the cold in winter because of their conditions. But it required all four nations to agree to that, and I've expressed my disappointment very directly to the UK government that we couldn't agree that.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm just wondering, in terms of the financial settlement and the discussions that our Deputy First Minister is having with the UK government, do you anticipate that it will have any impact in terms of aspects being devolved?
Well, the arrangements that... Well, there's a number of issues here. The arrangements that we would set up, any enhanced arrangements if we accept these recommendations, would be required to be funded here in Scotland, and you know we don't have an issue with that. The one area where we are in discussion is the area of support for people who were infected with HIV, because those schemes predated devolution. Essentially, those were schemes that are set up and funded on a UK basis through the Treasury. And while you know we would be keen to bring all those arrangements into one system in Scotland, but we would want, obviously, to ensure that the resources and some of the infrastructure costs are disaggregated, and that you know we get our fair share of that in terms of, as would Wales and Northern Ireland. So there's quite a few issues to be resolved. My main priority, though, is to try and get something in place, even on an interim basis, to get the payments out to people as quickly as possible.
I think that's very welcome news, Cabinet Secretary, and I'm sure those affected will be very pleased to hear that announcement. Finally, Convener, for me, we have also heard the impact that Hep C and other bloodborne conditions have on people's well-being. Have we made any representation at all to DWP on behalf of people with those conditions, maybe Hep C or haemophilia, in terms of the obviously the welfare reforms that's going through at the moment, but have we made any conversation with DWP to recognise the impact in terms of work and a financial recompense in a sense?
Well, what we've said very clearly is that if we accept the recommendations and we have an enhanced set of financial arrangements here in Scotland, whether that's the lump sum or the additional annual payments, that none of that should be affected either by benefits and that are already people are already entitled to or become entitled to, or indeed they shouldn't be taxed. They're not under the current arrangements, and we don't see why that should change for any enhanced arrangements here in Scotland. So we are still under discussion with the UK government, the DWP, about that. Gareth, do you want to?
Yeah, absolutely. The current recipients' payments received are not subject to tax and it has no impact on benefits. And there was a very clear message in the process of the Financial Review Group that from those who receive payments, of course, that should continue to be the case. And as Cabinet Secretary said, that's what we'd want. So in the discussions that we will have with the UK government about setting up new schemes in Scotland and indeed putting in place an interim arrangement to cover the time when we need to set up Scottish schemes, we would absolutely want that practice to continue, that benefits are not affected by payments under these ex gratia schemes.
Thank you very much. And I'm sure that's very welcome news to all those who the recipients. That's me, Convener. Thanks.
Thanks, Dennis. Rhoda?
I obviously welcome that you're looking at the recommendations of the review group, but there were some concerns. I think all our previous witnesses were keen that the recommendations were taken on board and put in place as soon as possible, but they weren't maybe the final stage. There was concerns about Skipton 1, Skipton 2, and indeed Skipton 0, where people could not prove that they had contaminated blood products and therefore didn't qualify for any compensation. Is there going to be work continuing into this? I mean, I think I've mentioned before a constituent who has Hep C and is absolutely debilitated by it, but doesn't have chronic liver disease and therefore can't qualify for Skipton 2. For many other people in that category, and indeed many people in the category where they can't even start, is this work going to continue to make sure that we pull in the greatest number of people that need compensation?
Yes, I mean, I was very struck by the proposal 5 from the review group. Within that, it says very clearly that the current thresholds for stage 1 and 2 of the Skipton Fund should be subject of a specific evidence-based review to create new criteria based on health impact rather than focusing predominantly on liver damage. That's absolutely right. It's going to take a bit of time to do that, though, and I think that's why we're trying to do this in stages. That first of all, though the review group is clear that it wants in its recommendation to get money to people as quickly as possible to those most affected and most need. So we, in my mind, should we accept the recommendations, that should happen, and while we get that done, we should be looking at getting on with the relationship between stage 1 and 2. I mean, there is international comparisons. If you look at Canada, I think they have 6 different stages, so that there's not a stage 1 and stage 2 with the diverse differences between them and nothing in between, whereas it's fair to stay within stage 1. We recognise that there are different health needs within stage 1 that the system at the moment doesn't really recognise that. So in short answer to your question, yes, and we see that as an important recommendation that's been made to us.
Can I ask about those that don't qualify at all because their medical records are maybe incomplete or proper records haven't been kept in the first place?
Yeah, Gareth, do you want to say?
Clearly that was an issue that was raised with us during the financial review, and I think there's a couple of comments to make there. One is our understanding at the moment is the schemes that currently exist don't require medical records. they adopt a low threshold of doubt, and they will rely on, for example, if a treating clinician thinks yes, it's reasonable to assume that they were infected by NHS. So it's not an absolute requirement that medical records are required. And we know that there are some people who've received payments without medical records. But clearly there's a sense there amongst the community that some people are being refused without good basis. And I think really what the core of this issue is actually about how the current schemes engage with the people that they make payments to. There was a real sense coming through that decisions are made in a locked room and the appeals mechanism isn't very good and it doesn't actually communicate very well the reasons or give people an opportunity to state their case. And I think one of the things the Cabinet Secretary will be reflecting on in line with the recommendations is when we set up schemes in Scotland, we want them to be much more open, much more transparent. So there will always be decisions made, I'm sure, that people aren't entirely happy with. But what's important is that those decisions are explained or communicated and there's a clear appeals process with a different set of people to make a second decision. And I think that's how we would hope to set up the schemes going forward.
I suppose that, I think the direction of travel is what that community would want, and I think we heard that in evidence earlier here today. We need to get to that point of financial help for people. And we've heard from the Cabinet Secretary that there'll be enhanced arrangements around that. So could you help us by describing what an enhanced arrangement means?
Well, essentially we've got a decision to make about accepting the recommendations of the review group. So if we accept the recommendations of the review group, what they recommended would be the enhanced arrangements,
right,
essentially, right? But the complexity of this is that what Gareth was describing about having a Scottish system, it's going to take a bit longer to establish. And we don't want people to have to wait until we get a Scottish system up and running. So meanwhile, we're talking to folks south of the border about how could we have some interim arrangements through the existing schemes to get payments. And before I announce what I'm going to do, I want to be in a clearer position about the delivery mechanism of that and when we'll be able to deliver it. So you'll appreciate that we're in some detailed discussions with the UK government and those who run the schemes down south to ensure that we're able to not just say we're going to do something, but we actually have the delivery mechanism and a time frame of being able to get the money into people's hands. I want all of that to be clear before I announce our decision. Obviously, I want, and I've said it, we will absolutely do that before PIRDA.
So you see that an interim basis has been a part payment or something?
No, I mean, I would say the ideal would be that we would be, if we accept the recommendations and the levels of payment as recommended through the review group, I would just see it's not about those payments reducing in any way. Those payments could be made. It's just how they're made, by what means, by through which scheme. And at the moment, they're most likely to have to be paid through the existing Skipton and Caxton scheme because we don't have a Scottish scheme established and it's going to take time to do that. So it's more about the technical side of how do we get, because they hold all the data and information about people that would, you know, we don't hold that information, and therefore it's going to take time for all of that to be passed over to a Scottish scheme. But ideally, I want to get the additional resources into the hands of people as quickly as possible.
So a Scottish team would be, a Scottish set-up would be after the financial arrangements have been settled and would deal with further actions.
I would imagine it would be setting up the Scottish system while payments, these additional payments are already being made through the existing schemes. I mean, the UK government's reviewing the schemes as it is. They want a different set of schemes anyway. So it's all going to be changed, but it's going to take time for us to get the Scottish end of that sorted out. But meanwhile, I want to use the existing schemes, if possible, to get the payments to people. We're in dialogue with the existing schemes about that, really. Mm. That's the short answer.
So, how would you get an interim payment? Who would be entitled then in Scotland to an interim payment? By the fact that they live here? The fact that they were contaminated here? Or
what,
if they're living in Canada or now living in England? Or how?
Well, the Skipton and Caxton funds already pay recipients in Scotland, and we pay into those schemes
to
pay people.
So you know them?
Yeah, we know who they are, and Essentially, the data information is held by Skipton and Caxton. We pay into those schemes so that Scottish recipients get the existing payments. Those people are already identified. I guess where we might get into is if new people are identified. Yeah. The new people could be identified tomorrow and then we could go on to the Skipton and Caxton schemes. But if we get a new set of Scottish arrangements in place, then clearly any new people could go directly onto that once it's established. But most people are known about already and they're already receiving payments. It's just that those payments are inadequate. That's why we set up the review group to look at that.
But if we know them, is it just getting money from the UK pot of money then that we to get agreement to do that, to pay them? Because we know where they are. What's stopping us from giving them an interim payment before the election?
A couple of things. First of all, we already pay for Scottish recipients. So Scotland pays into the Skipton Caxton Fund for Scottish recipients to get the money. We already pay that. But it's administered on a UK basis. So all of the data information about who they are is administered on a UK basis. What we're saying is, as the interim measure, we would enhance the payments we give to those UK schemes so that Scottish recipients would get a higher level of payment in line with the review recommendations. But eventually what we want to do is set up our own Scottish scheme to pay people. So it's not about the UK government paying anything. It's about us being able to use those existing schemes to pay more money out to folk in Scotland.
Do we not expect something out of the announcements of the UK funding of all of this?
We already pay for people in Scotland to receive money, apart from the HIV schemes, which are Treasury funded. That's the only scheme that's paid on a different basis. The other schemes, we already fund Scottish recipients.
Yeah, but I'm talking about the enhancement. If it goes from, what is it, to 30,000 to 50,000, is that the good way to put it? That enhancement, will none of that be funded by the UK government their announcements?
If we accept the review group recommendations, these are resources that we will pay here in Scotland. So
we don't get anything from UK government?
Well, other than if the schemes are disaggregated, there may be some infrastructure costs and administrative costs that would be shared out among Wales, Northern Ireland, Scotland and England. The HIV scheme is different. It was Treasury funded, so it would be treated in a different way and we would expect a share of that. I mean, if you look at the Department of Health review that they've put out, I mean, it makes very clear that what they're talking about is England only for English recipients, and they're talking about doing a different thing. They're taking things in a different direction than we are, and that's, you know, they're entitled to do that, and they're consulting on their arrangements. What we're doing here is trying to come up with the best set of arrangements for people in Scotland to meet their needs. The review group have given us the indication of what those priorities should be, but it will be for us to pay for that.
It was just some evidence we heard earlier. There was a concern from an earlier panel that the announcement of finance to support these enhancements in the new scheme included treatment costs, which was a concern to them because they felt that that was going to impact on payment. Mr. Brown?
Yeah.
I think, that's the UK government have announced, in terms of the Department of Health, have announced more money for treatment for people in England. But we already, they have been a bit slower to roll out their hepatitis C treatment, the new drug therapies. In Scotland, we're not in that position. So we've been a lot earlier getting the new drug Hep C therapies out there. So the review in England for England only has focused more of their attention on hepatitis C therapies to help people clear the virus. So we're talking about two different things here. One is around the review for England only, focused on Hep C therapies in the main, with a look at some of the other arrangements. And that's obviously for them to decide what they do around that. Our set of recommendations from the review group are very different, and our Hep C drug payments, as I said in my opening remarks, we already put £28 million a year into the system for Hep C drug treatment, and new drugs are all coming online all the time, and this year expecting more still. So we have a different set of issues to deal with. In England, they're a bit behind the curve in terms of the number of people that haven't had access to those Hep C drugs, and they're catching up to some degree, which is why the focus of their attention has been more on that.
Malcolm.
Your last 10-minute answer probably dealt with what certainly my initial question was about, because I was just trying to work out. It's, I mean, for me, it was a bit of deja vu, because you remember we had to sort out the powers to do a payment and whether it would affect Social Security. But I'm assuming that the latter issue is not really an issue anymore. We're assuming that that's, if it was all right before, it will be all right.
Exactly. Yet. That's our assumption as well. But we're getting it nailed down just to make sure. Yes.
So it sounds as if it's just the practical administration that you're dealing with. I mean, over and above that, which I think you've answered exhaustively about in the last 10 minutes, are there any other issues that you have to resolve in terms of the recommendation of the financial report, or is it just working out the practicalities with the UK government?
Well, first of all, we have to say whether we're accepting the recommendations, but I hope I've given you a flavour. I'm very sympathetic to those recommendations. I know that they've been long debated and thought through by the review group. Yes, I mean, it is the practical arrangements of how do we, what is the mechanism of getting that money into people's hands, and also making sure that we have nailed down the issues around it being on the same basis of being tax-free and no impact on benefits. We want that absolutely assured.
Is your intention to really pull it completely, so you have a completely separate Scottish scheme, or would it still be a Scottish scheme sitting within the existing arrangements?
The review group and those involved in the review group, actually people I've spoken to outside of the review group, all say the same thing, that their preference would be for a Scottish system, not just for administering money. I mean, that's a technical thing. You can do that anyway. But as Gareth laid out, there are other issues to consider about the tone and the kind of approach of the schemes. I've heard, you know, quite a few people feeling that they've had to jump through hoops and have had quite negative experiences in accessing some of the existing UK schemes. We would want to get Scottish arrangements to be coming at it from a bit of a different perspective, that they're trying to be helpful to people, to get, you know, to maximise the support to folk. Obviously, there will still need to be systems in place, but I think the whole kind of tenor of them, we could make a lot better than perhaps the feeling is around the existing Skipton and Caxton schemes.
Okay, I mean, a lot of what we heard this morning, obviously, initially was about the Penrose Inquiry, and you know the concerns about that have been expressed. I mean, is the government looking at the whole issue of the conduct inquiries in the light of the Penrose inquiry, or is that not really an issue that's on your radar?
I mean, there's not a formal review of the Inquiries Act, if that's what you mean, but clearly any inquiry, and we've had a few over the years where, you know, there have been issues around the length of time and cost. You know, we consistently would want to learn lessons from any inquiry that's carried out. But we can't get away from the fact that they are, you know, under the Inquiries Act, inquiries are set up, they're independent, so to start trying to interfere in the time frame and the cost, I mean, we can give guidance, and of course we have in a number of inquiries, you know, written to the chair of an inquiry saying, you know, we hope that you'll be keeping to the time scale as laid out, but ultimately we're very limited for good reasons about the independence of an inquiry in itself. It's that fine line of wanting an inquiry to get to the root of the matter, to do it in a timely fashion and, you know, within a reasonable cost. But ultimately, these things are difficult to always deliver, given the independent nature of the inquiries, for good reasons. So lessons that will be learned out of every inquiry.
I may be treading on someone else's toes, but I'm sure the issue of the recommendation and the implementation of it is obviously something we would want to hear about, and perhaps Professor Goldberg
could I bring Professor Goldberg in on that?
Well, thank you very much for asking me to provide evidence. We were asked to identify the extent of the challenge in relationship to the inquiry recommendation, and then decide on what more could be done. And I think this is in the context, I think it's quite an important consideration, because it was in the context of Scotland probably having done more than any other country in the world to tackle hepatitis C in terms of raising awareness, prevention, diagnosis, treatment and care. So one has to sort of consider all that's happened in the past, particularly over the last 7 or 8 years. And then, is there anything more that could be done? We also had to look at the impact of the publication of the Penrose Inquiry, because it generated an enormous amount of publicity. You know, you couldn't buy that sort of publicity. It was front page headlines. It was, I think, Shona, you were talking about it in Parliament, and it was also in UK Parliament as well. So there was an enormous amount there of awareness raising. And we took it upon ourselves to look at the impact of that publicity on HCV testing. And indeed, there was a serious impact. Several hundred people, if not perhaps even getting up to the 1,000 mark, did come forward in the few weeks following the publication of the inquiry, and particularly in the first week. And we had reports of general practices being inundated, and phone calls galore. And I think it was a bit of concern in the primary care setting, but it settled down. And so that I think was another dimension to all of this. A short life working group was established. I chair that. It's a multidisciplinary group. It has representation from a number of agencies, including Public Health England. I think we wanted to bring in some external view there. The UK Hepatitis C Trust. We met in October. We couldn't meet any earlier because we were waiting on the data surrounding the HCV testing data, which would indicate what impact the publication actually had. I think we had a very good meeting. Philip, I think, was at that meeting and made some very fine contributions to the debate. Out of that meeting, we were given the task to generate some more information, not just on the estimated number of people who infected remaining undiagnosed from the pre-1991 period, but also the number of people at risk, because if we were going to actually do anything about this, we would be focusing our attention on that group. And since October, Scottish Blood Transfusion Service has done some excellent work to estimate the size of that at-risk population, i.e. people who were transfused are still alive as at today. And we're talking about near 100,000 mark. I was actually quite surprised at the size of the population, but about 100,000 individuals are estimated to be alive and were transfused pre-1991. We don't think many of those individuals are infected. I think the number 200 was mentioned earlier today, and in some of the notes, we think probably around about 200 individuals who were infected are alive. Of these, the great majority, we think, have been diagnosed. And so that leaves us with about maybe 20 to 40. It's not an exact science. We're just doing our best to try and estimate the size of the infected population. But if it's 20 to 40, that means that probably about 1 in 2,500 to 1 in 5,000 of that 100,000 out there who are at risk are infected. And so that, I think, tells you what the challenge is. Of that 100,000 or so, what proportion have already been tested? Very difficult to tell. We just don't know. I think the majority probably haven't had a test. That said, we think the great majority of those infected, or the 200 that are infected and alive, probably have been diagnosed. And the reason for that is because 25, 30 years, even more, has elapsed between the time of their infection and today. There have been loads of opportunities for them to come through health systems. People get blood tests taken, liver function tests done, and if they've got raised enzymes, they will generally get tested for various viruses, including hepatitis C. Some will have developed symptoms, and that in itself will have promoted testing and therefore diagnosis. So there is a skew towards the diagnosis of those infected for those reasons. But for those who actually have received a blood transfusion and are at risk, I think generally speaking, and those and who are still alive, generally speaking, they won't have been tested. So that's where we are. A report is in preparation, including an option appraisal in terms of what can we do, what more can we do. That report will be in draft form, will be completed by the end of this month and circulated to the Short Life Working Group for comment. We're meeting again in late March, early April, and then following that, I hope that will be the final meeting. Hopefully, a few amendments to the draft report, and then the report will then be submitted to Scottish Government for its consideration.
What's the figure of 200? What was that? Based
that
on?
Figure of 200, that's the estimated number of people who infected through a blood transfusion pre-1991 and who are
based
alive.
On what was it based on?
Based on a whole range of modelling work, which...
Does the people who did come forward for testing after the report, do the results of that kind of match up with that kind
well,
of...
Well, I think we probably had... looking at the data, there were about 300 or 400 individuals who came forward for whom it was indicated in case notes that they came forward because of having had a blood transfusion or because of Penrose. There were others and there was no indication. But of that 400, one of the 400 turned out to be positive. But we don't know if that individual actually did acquire his or her infection through blood transfusion. So Scotland is in a very good position in relationship to data and trying to estimate the size of populations, infected and uninfected populations, probably better than most other countries. But you still, at the end of the day, there's still a bit of uncertainty around some of these estimates.
Annette Millen.
Actually, what I was going to ask has just been covered. I was concerned about that 200
okay, Fiona, number. You don't want to follow up. Okay. Richard Lyle.
Good morning. That's still morning, Cabinet Secretary. 30 years ago, this happened, disaster. 17 years ago, or 17 years, we've been talking about it and now finally getting to an end result. And can I personally thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for the work that you've done in the last number of months. Can I thank the First Minister and you for making a public apology to the people who suffered under this? And can I welcome the announcement you've just made this morning that this will be a Scottish scheme, a Scottish settlement, and basically that you will ensure that the announcement regarding any payout funding or whatever, I don't want to know figures, at this moment in time, will be made before the end of this Parliament, because the comment made, I think, by Mr
Bill Wright was the concern he had that would spill over to the next Parliament, and basically wanted to, you know, the system to be done. So basically it will be a Scottish scheme. You made a comment to me on a question I put to you some, I think a few weeks ago during the budget process, that payments will be made from the Scottish Government, won't affect local health boards, funding won't come out of local health boards. I want, again, if you could just confirm that. And basically, I know you've gave us a commitment, and sorry, I know you've answered quite a few number of questions, but basically, can we ensure that by the end of, or the middle of next month, because many people last night in social media were discussing that they wanted to see, and that this was a question I promised I would ask, that we'd have a financial closure or a financial system in place for people who have suffered for the last 30 years.
Can I, first of all, recognise your involvement in this issue and your campaigning over the years. I think, though, the people who are the people who should receive the most thanks are the campaigners out there, because I remember sitting around this table in the first Parliament and it was one of the first issues that the Health Committee dealt with, and if it hadn't been for the, you know, the campaigning and the fact that it was a group of people who had, many of whom had quite severe health needs themselves, but who got the attention of this Parliament and who made it an issue that was given the focus and attention, and led to Penrose, no matter what people think about the outcome of Penrose. If it hadn't been for the veracity of the campaigners, an inquiry wouldn't have come about. So a big thank you to all of them. And in answer to your questions, yes, I mean, it will be, of course, we'll make an announcement before Purdah because people want to know. You'll appreciate we're trying to get the I's dotted and T's crossed around some of the mechanisms, but I want to be able to answer yes, the new financial arrangements will be funded through Scottish Government. Obviously, the Hep C drug therapies will continue to be funded through health boards, and they have obviously targets set around how many people should be treated each year, and so on and so forth. And we will want to get those financial systems up and running as quickly as possible. But, you know, that does require us to get some of these practicalities sorted. But, you know, we would want to do that as quickly as is absolutely possible, and that's the focus of the discussions that Gareth and his team have been having with folk down in the Department of Health and those in charge of the existing schemes.
Can I, one more question, Convener, to Professor David Goldberg. You're saying about the number of 200. So prior to 1991, over 100,000 people possibly. If I was in a car accident then and was in a coma or didn't know that I'd got a blood transfusion, basically, how would I know that I've got Hep C? Yeah. And the point that I think was made again this morning was that if I get, you know, I take the point, if we get into a doctor, discussing with a doctor could possibly tell us, or, you know, I've had a blood test, I've had blood pressure tests, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. My wife gets very annoyed when I tell her I've got one of the best blood pressures that the people have came across, supposedly, I'm told. But if I get into hospital today, am I tested for Hep C? You know, say I get into A&E, that's the point. The recommendation of Penrose, the one recommendation was that we check, that in Scotland we check, are there more people out there with the greatest respect to those people that require our help, or require our assistance. So, with the greatest respect to you, Professor, how can we say there's only 200 people? I might have been in a, you know, I wasn't in a car crash, by the way. I haven't ever received a blood transfusion. But how can we say there's only 200, we suspect there's only 200 people? We honestly don't know.
Well, it is an estimate. I'm not saying that only 200 people acquired HCV through blood transfusion. It was many more than that. What I'm saying is that we think that the great majority are now have died, and there are now 200 still living. All these estimates are based on a range of data available to us, and assumptions are made, and we do our best to provide an estimate of the size of the... And there are confidence intervals around that estimate. That's a central sort of estimate. There's a low figure and a high figure. I think your point about an individual knowing whether or not he or she had a blood transfusion is a good one, actually. I think it's a really important point, because not everybody would know. And so this is actually a really tricky area, and certainly all the things you're just, I think, alluding to are going to be considered in this option appraisal. What to do? What more can we do in the context of the reasonable steps that Penrose is talking about? So we'll do this option appraisal, and then we will come up with a favoured option, and that will be submitted to government. I think the other point to make is that one of our challenges is that although we think the numbers here are small, they're very important, very, very important, but also we've got to consider that there are probably in the region of 14,500 people in total with hepatitis C in Scotland who remain undiagnosed. Now, Scotland's got one of the best case-finding records of any country anywhere in the world, but still there are maybe 35 to 40% of the total infected population that remain undiagnosed. I think Philip alluded to this earlier, that we can't just look at this group in total isolation. Although Penrose is about this group, we need to also think of that undiagnosed context, the 14,500, and the very great majority of these are people who have injected drugs in the past, probably no longer inject drugs, most of them. And we need to do as much as possible to try and identify them, because there are new therapies out, they're very, very effective, and these individuals can benefit from these therapies. So it's a challenge. But that said, Scotland has and will continue to do I think a really good job on this front.
Can I ask one last question, Convener, through you to the Cabinet Secretary? And Professor Goldberg just reminded me of it. We make announcement next month. People who have died, the families who don't have their loved one there any longer, what retrospective provision are we making? Are we making any retrospective provision? Or I don't know the findings of the review group, so I'm asking you what if you could give us that information, or if you can't, I'm quite happy to wait until next month.
I mean, this is obviously a difficult area. Going forward, certainly we recognise that, the review group recognised the needs of widows and widowers, and they've one of the things that was very important to them was to ensure that those widows and widowers receive support. So one of the recommendations was that a proportion of the support given to the person concerned would continue after their death. Obviously, that's going forward rather than being retrospective. And in terms of the current schemes, in terms of support for...
So in the current schemes, there's discretionary funding which is available to widows and families. I think this is one of the areas where the patient groups tell us that this is quite often difficult funding to access. One of the other recommendations within the financial review is, in addition to future widows, if I think of it that way, so when a primary recipient dies in the future, they will receive 75% ongoing. The group also recommended that widows of people who've died in the past should also be eligible for that 75% of what their partner would have received going forward. So one of the bits of work we'll have to do is, that doesn't exist at the moment, one of the bits of work we'll have to do is work out how can we make that work, how can we, and some of these people will be not in contact with schemes anymore. They may have had somebody who died 10 years ago, and it's about trying to track them down. And I know the group in particular were concerned that there may be widows out there who have moved on or who aren't in contact with schemes anymore, but who would be eligible for this funding under a new Scottish scheme if these recommendations were accepted. So there is absolutely something in there for the future bereaved, but also people who've been bereaved in the past.
Thank you, Kinnear.
Just a couple of wee supplementaries, I think, in regard to Professor Goldberg and that at-risk group, that, not all of them, maybe the 14,500, but and whether the Scottish Government has got a view of extending tests to drug users from the 70s, 80s and the 90s?
Well, I mean, the way that the system works at the moment is that anybody who presents who may have been at a kind of high risk would be encouraged to have a test. Obviously, the person, you know, it's ultimately their decision. But clearly, given we want as many people as possible to get access to these new therapies that in the vast majority of cases can clear the virus, you know, the whole emphasis is on trying to identify who those people are, no matter what the circumstances of their infection, and to get them onto the new drug therapies. So, you know, that's the whole thrust of the strategy at the moment. And as more drugs are developed, and as I said earlier, like, there's new drugs coming on stream this year. You know, these drugs are very, very effective, very different from the therapies of the past. And again, that's an important message about there's fewer side effects. So people who may have decided not to have the previous treatment are opting to have this treatment because the side effects are much less.
It's just in terms of the, you know, sort of the brief and the evidence, I presume that is there, you know, regular drug tests and are a program to test those who were drug users in the 70s and 90s. But is that group being caught at this point? Is it something that would be considered reasonable to do to extend active testing around about that group of people? Or is that just been misled from the brief or the...
Huge range of initiatives to promote testing among not just current people who currently inject drugs, but people who have injected in the past. And I think this is a very important group, the people who have injected in the past, 70s, 80s, because they may well have more advanced liver disease. And we have done some surveys of general practitioners throughout the country, and they do report very high rates of offering individuals who they believe have ever injected drugs in the past, offering them a test for hepatitis C. That said, there's still work to be done because 14,500 is still a large number of individuals. But we've got to put it in context. Before the action plan, we had under 40% of people infected people diagnosed. Now, at this particular point, over 60%. And every year, another 2,000 individuals, an additional 2,000 individuals are being diagnosed. So a lot of really good work is being done. We have been sort of scratching our heads to think, well, is there anything more that can be done and should be done? It's not an easy one. But I think within this option appraisal that we're doing, what will come out is, I think, a recommendation which doesn't just focus in on those who acquired the infection through blood transfusion, but who also got it in other ways, got the infection in other ways.
Yeah. Is there an issue about the historical then and their impact on themselves and the community then? Is it something that will be considered or not?
Yeah, I mean, I think it may be that if people are not in contact with services anymore, then you know they're obviously harder to find. But I think, as David's laid out, that you know GPs are very proactive in having that conversation with somebody about perhaps whether or not previous drug taking behaviour may encourage them to have a test, for example. Well, these things are obviously difficult discussions that happen between clinicians and patients. I think what Dave is also saying, though, is that the work they're looking at just now about how can we do more to try and find those who are currently undiagnosed, no matter how they were infected, will have a benefit not just to those who were infected through a blood transfusion, but that wider group of people as well, and that will be something that we'll obviously receive in due course from David's group once they've put their conclusions together.
Just the other wee one that was mentioned with extensive evidence from Petra Wright, and I think I've got this right, the extent of which extra hepatic conditions should have a key component in the eligibility criteria for financial support. Do you have a view in this, and given the evidence that we've had both written and oral this morning about not just focusing on the liver, to put it in layman's terms, but about the wider impact on the individual and body and outcome?
Yeah, I mean, the further work proposals that the review group came up with captures that really they said, you know, that, well, first of all, within stage one, people at stage one, there's a big variety of health issues. Some people have cleared the virus, may have very few health impact, although not under, you know, playing the psychological and emotional impact of having been infected at all. That's obviously recognised. But within stage one, there will be people who have significant health needs. So there's a wide variety, and the review group recognised that and said that we should look at whether or not there needs to be a various bands rather than just stage one and stage two, but also that the research is beginning to show that actually there may be a whole range of conditions that are linked to hepatitis C infection, that you know, it's taking time to understand those a bit more. So we need to keep on top of the evidence and what that's telling us. So it's not just about the focus, not just on liver damage. So that further work that the review group has recommended would be part of the response that I'll give, not just on the financial elements that they've recommended, but the future work that they've said should take place, which includes what you've outlined there.
Okay. Does the Canadian model and the six-stage model take those wider?
Yes, it does, and we've had a look at that. Gareth looked at that in some detail, and I think there are international models that may be something we would want to look at when we establish our Scottish system that's more, a bit more responsive to the needs of people.
Rhoda Grant.
Can I just ask a quick supplementary and then get to my substantive question? I understand from this morning's earlier session that the short-term working group that Professor Goldberg is chairing has only met once, and I'm just wondering how, if it's only met once, is it in a position to report? Has there other work been ongoing in kind of between the first meeting and what will be, I think you said, the last meeting when the report is drawn up?
And one of the actions generated by the group, which met in October, was to generate estimates of the size of the at-risk population. And Blood Transfusion Service were asked to do that work, and they have now deliberated. There are one or two other smaller pieces of work that needed to be done. And so the group are now going to meet. We've struggled a little bit. They were going to meet this month, but we've struggled with dates, and they will meet again, hopefully for the final time, in March or early April.
So the working group will only have met twice when it reports?
Well, I mean, we'll just have to wait and see. I'm hoping that it is a short life working group. I'm hoping that the group will agree, will come to a conclusion. Draft report will be sent in advance to them, to the group, and so they'll have that in advance of the meeting. I think I don't anticipate too much in the way of change following that, following the meeting, and I'm hopeful that we can get a final report up to government just shortly after we meet. So that's the position.
I mean, it wouldn't be unusual to say that, you know, a group would have a lot of other work going on by other people that they've requested the work from in between meetings, and then it's about analysing that and coming up with some conclusions, I guess, when you've just outlined that there was other pieces of work that were that other organisations were asked to provide to you.
Indeed. I mean, there are a number of things there. I mean, I think we didn't meet until October, but we were waiting for the results of the HCV test data in relationship to the publication of the inquiry, as I mentioned earlier. I think it's just been a few months for the SNBTS work to be done and a few other bits and pieces, and now we're meeting. And a report has to be written. I think in the context of the inquiry, in general, I think that seems quite reasonable. I don't really have any concerns about that.
Okay. Can I go on to my second question, which is about blood and tissue samples that may be held from sufferers? There's concern that those are being held and used for research. And I wonder what the Cabinet Secretary is going to do about maybe identifying if that's the case, and if so, making sure that those who have blood and tissue samples being used in research are informed and their consent is sought.
Mm-hmm. Gareth, do you want to answer?
Yeah. It's an issue that's been raised. We're not aware specifically that there's a big problem, but of course there may be samples held historically that people don't know what they are, and tracking it down. I think the important thing is that there are the right sort of regulatory arrangements in place to ensure that the right consents are gathered where it's possible to do that. And there is a process, I understand. Healthcare Improvement Scotland is responsible for developing standards, assessing performance, and there's an accreditation scheme setting out the governance arrangements for repositories of tissues and samples. So there's certainly arrangements in place. I think the challenge is trying to find historic samples, but clearly under the current arrangements, any samples that were identified would need to be dealt with under the governance arrangements which now exist, which is all about absolutely informed consent, making sure people have the opportunity to see what happens to their samples. But we're not aware of there being, you know, there's not banks of tissue, and we've gone through clearly a number of issues in the past about retention of organs, and we've had human tissue legislation which is in this area. So it may have been an issue in the past because of how the NHS worked, but it certainly shouldn't be an issue now, and there's clear governance arrangements that exist. So if any samples emerge or any tissues emerge, they would be dealt with under those governance arrangements, absolutely.
What we will do, though, is we'll make sure that Healthcare Improvement Scotland are made aware of the evidence that was presented to the committee on this, and they can have a look at that and just reassure, I think, themselves and us, indeed, that all of that is now being followed as it should be, and that really what we're talking about here is, as Gareth said, more historic samples that, rather than anything not being carried out as it should be under the current legislation, which obviously is very detailed and this committee was very involved in establishing.
But samples taken historically would come under the new legislation. One would assume that they, if they were being held, they shouldn't be being held with, without permission.
I think we would need to... that would come down to the determination of the what the legislation says, and I don't have a view on that. We need to check. But certainly the governance arrangements exist, which are not necessarily about legislation. It's about the accreditation scheme and the processes bodies and research organisations should follow. I would expect that any historic samples which come to light should be considered under that sort of process. I can't today say what the legislation says because I'm not clear on that. We'd need to check that.
What we'll do is we'll check that. We'll get back to you on that specific point, but we'll also, as I say, make Healthcare Improvement Scotland aware of the concerns that have been raised and ask them to reassure themselves and us around those issues.
Nanette Millen.
To mention that there's been quite a lot of frustration expressed to us about the small number of case studies that were actually examined during the Penrose evidence taking. And I just wondered, is there any intention, again, people very much felt they hadn't had their day in court, you might say, to put across their own experiences. Is there any intention to investigate the other people who were affected, but who in fact weren't interviewed by Penrose?
I mean, it was obviously... this is obviously very difficult because it was a matter for Lord Penrose and the inquiry to, you know, decide which and how many witnesses and oral testimony that he wished to take. Obviously had to satisfy the terms of reference, but otherwise there was a great deal of flexibility around that. I think normally inquiries would try to get a range of specific cases to highlight different circumstances and be able to look at the, you know, different circumstances. But again, you know, the independence of the inquiry, it really leaves it to the inquiry to determine what that, how many that should be. But, you know, we would expect any inquiry to take a range and make sure there was a range of circumstances looked at. I mean, I understand the frustration. I've spoken to people very directly who felt that they should have been, you know, given the opportunity to be heard in front of the inquiry. But as I say, it's not for us as politicians to determine that. The inquiry had to determine that. But I do understand people's frustrations.
Thank you. I just thought it was important to put that on the record for this committee.
Thank you. Thank you. Is there any other questions for the committee? Cabinet Secretary, there's no other questions. Can I thank you and your colleagues for being with us this morning and the evidence provided. Thank you very much indeed. We now move to agenda item 3, subordinate legislation. We have 4 negative instruments before us today. First one is the Public Bodies Joint Working Prescribed Health Board Functions Scotland Amendment Regulations SSI 2016/15. There has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Do we have any comments from members? No comments from members. Can I take it from that the committee has agreed to make no recommendation? Thank you. The second instrument is the National Assistance Sums for Personal Requirements Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016/23. Again, there has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Do members have any comments? No comment from committee members. I take it from that the committee has agreed to make no recommendation. Thank you. The third instrument is the Products Containing Meat, etc. Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, SSI 2016/24. There has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Do any committee members wish to make comment? No. So I take it from that the committee are agreed to make no recommendations. Thank you. The fourth and final instrument before us this morning is the National Assistance Assessment of Resources Amendment Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016/25. There has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Do any members have any comment? No comments from the committee members. I take it from that the committee has agreed to make no recommendations. Agreed. Thank you very much. That's all agreed. Thank you. Our fourth item on the agenda today is consideration of petition PE1492 by Alan Kennedy, co-location GP practices and community pharmacies, which, as you'll see from your papers, I note that the committee member has agreed and be communicated with, and the petitioner has advised that he's happy for this petition to close at this point. Of course, it would remain open to the petitioner to bring forward any other petitions around this matter, if in the fullness of time it transpires that the work currently underway to address the issues from their petition do not improve services. Are there any views from the members? Can the committee agree then that we close the petition? Thank you very much. As we previously agreed, we now go into private session.